Hello, everyone, and welcome. It is August 31st, 2022, and we are having the 120th consecutive weekly Knowledge Bolide Hangout sponsored by Topherspin Meteorites. Today, a little bit different than most days. Most shows, all we show are meteorites. Tonight, I don't think we're going to see any meteorites. And to explain why that is, I'm going to have my beautiful wife, Sue, introduce today's topic. Sue?
Hey, guys. I hope you're all doing well. Today, the topic for our hangout is impactites. We're doing this by popular demand. It has been requested for a very long time. So tonight, we're going to learn what impactites are, how they're different from meteorites, how they're formed, and we'll also discuss some of the main categories. Some of them you've probably heard of, like Moldavite or Libyan Desert Glass. There may be others that you're not as familiar with, but we're going to learn all about that during Meteorite 101 tonight. And then after that, throughout the whole show, we're going to be seeing different specimens of these impactites, and the crew has some really great specimens to share with us. Back to you, Topher.
Awesome. Thank you. And we're going to come back to you at the end of the show for an announcement. So don't forget about that. Normally, this first crew member, we call him the Iron Man because, man, he has some irons in his collection, and that's kind of what floats his boat. We're talking about Ron Metchis. So, Ron, we're talking about impactites, and I'm really hoping you're going to show us some beautiful Libyan desert glass, among other things.
Yeah, I got some really nice pieces, and outstanding pieces. I'm going to show you two, and we're going to start with just a gorgeous piece, a Libyan desert glass with a little surprise in it. This is my best one. I believe. See the little pebble right there?
Oh, yeah.
That's cool.
That was the way it came from the desert. So I got this in Tucson a few years back. I just love the transition from the yellow to the black. It's got everything. So that groove in there is what really made it for me.
That is fantastic. Most Libyan desert glass, we're going to see a few samples today. You'll notice that there's a variety of colors of Libyan desert glass, and Mike will hopefully explain why they're different colored. But this one is super green. Like, that is like super green. Living well,
and the texture that you see on the
this looks like a keystone steak to me.
That Libyan desert glass you just showed was like one of the darkest ones I've ever seen. Like, it's really, really nice.
This one is about it's over almost a kilo, but if you look at it, I posted this one, it's actually apple green all the way through.
Wow.
I actually did a special video on this one.
That's crazy.
I got this from Blaine Reed just this past Tucson show.
Yeah.
Actually, camera doesn't do it justice. I mean, in person, it's much, much nicer. But I beat out Beth Carrillo by about 5 minutes on this one.
She must hate you.
That's beautiful, man.
So
look at that edge, that flat edge.
Yeah.
It's so smooth.
Yeah, there's actually this edge right here. You know, get a flash on it. It's actually got a lot of little regolith in there.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Those are two primo examples of Libyan desert glass.
Those are exceptional.
Yes.
So let me move on.
Ron, usually when you have a piece that size with that flat of a side on it, it's because it's broken. No, and that's why, broken. But that one is not. Yeah.
Got a couple little chips up here, but I won't hold that against it.
No, but you can see that it looks, it's melted glass, basically.
Yeah, I fully expected that entire side to be the shiny brokenness that you see in those little chips.
No, it's
wow.
Actually a very beautiful piece. I was surprised that it was as green as it. I mean, it's just pure apple green all the way through.
Yeah.
First time I saw this, I thought it was just something special.
Yeah, right, so I remember seeing that in Blaine's room.
Yeah, he had it back in the corner. He was considering not selling it. I kind of talked him into it. I'm gonna go from there to some Rizalites. I have two of these. I saw two at a show. I got to get these in the middle of the camera. I couldn't figure out which one to buy, so I bought both.
Tough problem to have.
That's my go-to move.
What are those Rizalites?
I've had people call these Bikolites. Some people call Rizalites. And frankly, I think the term is used interchangeably, although there's a Bicol province and a Rizal province in the Philippines. I lived there for 15 months. I'm very familiar with it.
So these are both from the Philippines?
Yes, these are called Philippinites.
Okay.
All right.
I think he's making this up. It looks like he was bad and Santa brought him coal.
I mean, just this natural sheen on there is just gorgeous.
Is there any translucency on these near the edges?
No translucency.
No, they're deep black.
Yeah. Okay. So that one. No, there's no light coming through.
No.
I have a very bright light coming through. And no, there's nothing.
Hmm.
So these are my two Philippinites.
They're shiny.
These are big ones.
Yeah.
These are very big for this kind of a meteorite. Okay, we'll go from there.
Those are not meteorites. Tektites.
Oh!
So I'm going to go from there to some Indochinites. These are called splash form Indochinites. I have three that I want to show. This one's kind of a bent tube. This one looks like a barbell. And of course, you got to have the teardrop. So you can see how big these are. These are all over 100 grams, 140 gram region, roughly.
Wow.
And they are just absolutely, look at the flashlight here. My light is not doing me justice today. So I picked these up actually at a local gem show here in California, which I don't usually find meteorites of Ventura. So this
maybe
is my-
because they're impactites?
Yeah, the impactites, yes. So this one here, I actually got from a Chinese lady in Tucson.
That's almost perfect form.
Yeah. It's a very nice form going. Kind of like a hot dog. And this one here, I've never seen one this curved before.
Yeah.
And this is actually the biggest one. This weighs about 150 grams.
Yeah. Later on, Mike is going to talk about how they're formed a little bit, because you hinted that these are called splash or splash forms.
Yeah. And I'm just going to talk about it, but if he wants to talk.
Oh, go ahead. No, tell us a little bit.
What they are. These are formed from a meteorite impact. The surface material is melted instantaneously, thrown up into the air, and it falls back to Earth. As it spins, actually it starts more or less like this one. As it spins, it starts to stretch, and you get, if you can picture two of these on each end, they spin, they pull apart, and that's what forms the teardrop.
Yes.
I'm not sure how this one, I'm sure it's spinning function, but it's all, you know, the color is from the local, whatever the impurities are in the sand. Like Libyan Desert Glass is the same kind of thing, but it's not a splash form. It's a totally different color. It just happens to be whatever the surrounding material is.
And just to clarify for everyone, these are terrestrial material that have been transformed by a meteoritic impact. So we're looking at earth material, sand, whatever, that has been melted. We appreciate you showing those off. Again, those are Bikonites or Rizalites. And also the Libyan Desert Glass was spectacular.
Thank you.
Before we do a little bit more show and tell and learning, we're not going to show meteorites, but I want to talk about meteorites. A new meteorite was witnessed over Utah, and one of our crew members, Getty, actually went out and hunted the strewn field. So Getty, would you mind telling us a little bit about your experience?
Yeah, sure. So I think it was back on Saturday, August 13th, there was a daytime fireball in the morning witnessed right over Salt Lake City, Utah. And couple of days later, Sonny Clare, I believe it was the first person to find one of those meteorites, and that set off, you know, the hunt for it. So I decided this past weekend to pack up my e-bike, make the drive over, and give it a hunt. So it was about half an hour to the west of Salt Lake City, Utah, and most meteorites have been found in this dried salt bed that was just to the west of the Great Salt Lake. So went out there, it was, you know, probably low to mid 90s, sun blazing on you the entire time, and just went around cruising looking for space rocks. Unfortunately, I'm there a little bit late, and so most of the area had already been gridded. I mean, you could already see the tracks from the ATVs just paralleling the entire area. So ended up trying to find some of the you know, maybe harder to hunt areas, more vegetated areas. There are shockingly a couple of those even in these salt flats, but unfortunately nothing found this time. But you know, I did gain a lot of experience and met some people, managed to talk to others, and find more information on how to get the information regarding these falls earlier and hopefully get out there. So I'm looking to get out there for the next fall that I can easily access and hopefully hunt and find then.
Awesome. Well,
do you know, did anybody map out the strewn field at all while they were there?
I know that the finds have been documented as to their locations. I don't know if the full strewn field has been mapped out. I don't know if there's enough data yet. There really haven't been a lot of meteorites found, maybe a dozen, maybe 20 or so, to my knowledge. I think one that I know of has been found to the east of the Great Salt Lake, and most of them have been to the west in that that salt flat.
Well, you gotta put in the hours and you gotta put in the effort, and you definitely did that. So we definitely appreciate your attempt at recovery and retelling the story for us and sharing with the crew. Thank you,
Danny. Yeah, I think overall it was 50 miles traveled over 2 days, and was 18 hours of hunting.
Wow. Well, I'm glad
your first hunt, by the way.
This was my first hunt. Yes.
Wow. Congratulations. That's a great experience. Yeah, congratulations for having the balls to get out there and do it, man, because even if you don't succeed, man, you got under your belt your first successful hunt and you didn't die.
Yes. My girlfriend was definitely worried I was going to wander out into the desert and die alone, but no. Brought plenty of water, shade, cover, all that, and basically had a plan, knew what I was doing, and you know, I've done hikes in very hot areas before, so I know what I'm getting myself into. Hats off to everybody who went out to Cranfield there. I know we got a couple of crew members who did that and managed to find some stuff. But I hear the stories of, you know, hunting through all that with the snakes and not only the heat there, but the humidity also, which is something that you really didn't have to fight with in Salt Lake City. It was dry.
There's a lot of dangers in meteorite hunting. And we're going to actually have a story retold to us on the hangout of another group of hunters that didn't plan ahead as well. They had some mechanical difficulties and it ended up with almost a medical emergency times three. So stay tuned to the channel for that.
I was talking with that person and he warned me. He said, make sure that you bring plenty and plenty of water, because this is what could happen.
Yeah, no joke. I heard some of the details and we're going to share them with you guys, because it was a very harrowing story. So Giddy, thank you for giving us that update. Really appreciate
your efforts
going out there trying to collect the newest science on Earth.
Cheers.
We're going to switch gears a little bit. We have some video presentations now of Impactites. So let's take a look at that. As I said, it's our 120th episode in a row, and we're dealing with Impactites today. So we're going to have some show and tell on some items from Oz Backman's collection. This is a beautiful shatter cone.
This is a beautiful example of a shatter cone. This is from Steinheim, Germany, and really, really shows that awesome shatter cone feature. Again, the wide area of the shatter cone points to the point of impact, and the narrow side always points down. So this would be its orientation in the ground. Beautiful horsetail feathering.
And if you have any questions about shatter cones, wait for Mike's 101 today. But I had to show that off because that's a beautiful example of one. And you can really see the raised and 3D features there. This next one is a piece of Pica glass from Oz Backman's collection.
This is a pretty cool 30-gram sample of Pica glass from the Atacama Desert in Chile. Really porous material. This one doesn't seem to be as friable as most pieces I've seen. But it's still very, very light.
The closest thing that that reminds me of is like Trinitite.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was thinking like lava. Yeah. Lava as it cools and gets wet.
You can tell that it was a very violent and heated event that caused it. Next is Ben Fissler, and he has a bunch of items to show us today.
Hi, this is Ben Fissler. I'm going to give you a brief look at impact materials that were created by either cometary impacts or asteroidal impacts with the planet's surface or atmosphere, which created a lot of heat and energy that changed terrestrial materials into their present form. I'm going to start with this Pica glass. It's from the Atacama Desert in Chile. It's got a lot of vesicles from the release of expanding gases. Next, I have some Darwin glass. And it also is a dark color. This piece is black with kind of some white streaks. It also has vesicles. It's from Western Tasmania, Australia. And from what I read, there's a large crater in the same area. Next, I have some Libyan desert glass. Some of the pieces are translucent. Some of the pieces are transparent. And it usually has this golden color. It's very pretty. It's considered a semi-precious stone in that it was used by the pharaohs 3,000 years ago to make particular jewelry pieces that has been found in their tombs. It has a weathered exterior, kind of like a ventifact. Next I have Moldavite, and it comes from Southeast Germany and the Czech Republic. And see if I can light it up a little. You can see it's transparent in places. It's beautiful stuff. And it's usually this dark green. Sometimes it's brown. Next, I have Tektites. And the Tektites come from Asia and Australia. They come in a variety of colors, black, brown, or gray. They also come in a variety of shapes, spherical pieces, dumbbells, teardrops, ellipsoids, buttons, and they have a lot of vesicles as well.
I love that Hershey Next, kiss.
I have some impact breccia. Here's one from the Alamo impact site in central Nevada. And as you can see, it's got a lot of brecciation and melt lines. It's a beautiful piece.
Again, I don't want to interrupt you, Ben, but when we're looking at this, I want to just remind people that this is a piece of terrestrial rocks all mashed together and melted underneath the pressure of an impact.
It's actually quite beautiful.
Here's a piece from the Kentland crater in Indiana. It also has a lot of brecciation. And that's a brief look.
Nice. Ben, that was a great video. Thank you really much. I appreciate you putting that together for us. And Allison, if you thought that was pretty, wait till you see this next one. This is from Damian. He sent in this video. There's no...
It's Maxine.
Maxine. Sorry. Thank you, baby. This You're is welcome. Maxine. This is Breccia, Impact Breccia from the Ukraine. You guys can feel free to talk because there's no audio here.
You know, we know that these are extraterrestrial events because you have to get up into the gigapascal level of pressure in order to cause this sort of disruption to terrestrial rocks. And outside of nuclear explosions, there have not been any man-made events that get well into that gigapascal range.
Thank you, Pat. Yeah, how would you like to have a whole slab of this as your countertop in your kitchen?
That'd be all right.
Yeah, I think we can all deal with that.
Yeah.
Those are some pretty fantastic videos. I really appreciate the crew coming together and making those videos for us. Now, just so we don't go so far deep down the path, talking and showing examples, it's time to stop and learn exactly what a tektite is, what an impactite is, how it differs, and more than you could ever think about. So we're going to switch gears to Meteorite 101 impactites with Mike Kelly.
Evening, everybody. So this is the impactite 101. So this is a high level breakdown. Basically, impactites, you can divide them up kind of into four very coarse categories. Impact glass, and that contains your tektites. And then we'll talk a little bit about what proximal glasses are. Then you have melts. So these are anything with a partial melt or a complete melt. And then you have breccias, which are angular lithified bits of existing rock. And kind of the last catch-all category is shocked items. So impact glasses, I talked about a type that's called proximal. So those are anything that's relatively close to the impact crater that formed them. So Ron showed some great pieces, some Libyan desert glass, some Pica glass, and a couple of other things. So again, these are all things that are glassy in nature. So that means the material that they're made out of completely melted all the minerals in there, and they quenched. They cooled so quickly that new minerals couldn't form out of them. So they have ions that are all just interscattered. They still have the composition of the rock they came from, but not the structure.
Mm. Very interesting. And Darwin glass, because I heard on Ben's video, Darwin glass is different than Libyan desert glass. It comes from Australia.
Yeah. Different location, and it's got a much different character to it. It's usually very dark in color, brown to black in color. It is glassy. It is just like Libyan desert glass, though, and Pica glass. You know, it's a surface inlaid glass. So it wasn't thrown anywhere. It was kind of just a part of like a melt sheet that formed after an impact, most likely an aerial burst, because I believe there's no crater associated with the Darwin glass.
Okay. And Mike, could you do me a favor and explain the last three to me, because I'm not very familiar with them.
Sure. So Wa'ul glass is just a location. It's very similar in look to the Darwin glass. It's a darker form of glass. A lot of people are familiar with rice crater impactites and shatter cones. Flatal is actually a term from the local area that describes a glassy piece of material created as an impactite in the rice crater area. And actually, the bottom centerpiece in that image is a piece of flatal, the gray on the bottom. Gotcha. And zergatites are also a type of locally created glass. That's the piece that says 115 over there on the side. Mm-hmm. They almost look like tektites, They're very glassy. They have lots of little beads on them. They're all typically splash forms, like Ron was mentioning. So there'll be teardrops or little barbellish or buttons that were thrown material, but it wasn't really thrown far, which would be the next category we're going to look at in the next slide, which is tektites. Distal glass. So distal means it was just thrown a really far distance. And those would be your tektites. That's kind of one of the criteria for being a tektite, is it's found really nowhere near the crater that formed it. You're talking thousands of miles away for some of these. And besides being thrown a very long distance, the amount of force that takes typically means that these glasses are more pure glass than you would find in the pieces of glass that are nearby. So there's less contaminants in there. It's almost pure silica. And that even includes moisture content. So these have almost no moisture content in them. Like Pat was saying, it takes a very high amount of gigapascals to throw something that far. And so the heat and pressure from that impact basically drives all the water and everything else out of them, and you just have near pure silica. So there are tektites from all over the place. I kind of listed them out here. I'm not going to read through them all. I will highlight, I did miss one on this list, and I'll show that at the end because I missed it.
Okay. I have a question for you on this slide. I don't mean to interrupt ever and talk over you, but we see something on there that I know is extremely rare, hard to get, and expensive, a flanged button. Is that yours?
Truth be told, that is a replica of a flanged button.
Oh, I was going to say, they are freaking hard to get. A small story, don't want to get off the subject too much, but I happened to be at the Busick Center for Meteorites, ASU, and Dr. Lawrence Garvey was giving me a tour. And when he got to this one drawer, I mean, there's millions of dollars of meteorites laying everywhere. When he got to this one drawer, he asked us all to step back 6 feet. He took out this flanged button from Australia, held it in his hand with his hand shaking, and look from where you are. Don't, like, he was more scared of that thing getting breathed on than anything. So I nearly had a conniption fit when I saw your picture.
Yeah, no, those are definitely, that's definitely a replica, because like you said, they are rare, and rare commands pricey. So moving on to impact melts. So the interesting thing at Impactites I want to talk to also a little bit is the fact that it's a continuum, right? So we said there's kind of like four main buckets they fall into, but things don't cleanly go into one or the other. Some bits have aspects of being glassy and then also being a melt. Some melts have some breccia characteristic to them. So there's a kind of a whole continuum between the different types of impactites out there. So impact melts will all have, obviously, like the name says, a melt aspect to them. And what that means is everything turned molten, but then it cooled slow enough that very fine crystals were able to come and be formed. So if the entire thing is all melt, then it's an impact melt rock. If there's some chunks of relatively unaltered rock inside of it and there's melt around it forming the matrix, and it's an impact melt breccia. And then we have these bottom ones called suvites, which that's the everyone knows from Rice Crater, is kind of the most famous location. And what those are is it's a combination of a little bit glassy, a little bit melty, a little bit breccia. And we talk about flatal, those aerial thrown pieces of glass. Some of those are actually contained inside of the classic Rice crater breccia or impact melt material. You'll get those glass bombs incorporated inside the material as they landed and got lithified into it.
And talking about recrystallization, this one over here on the right-hand side, you can tell that it cooled slower than the Pica glass that we were looking at earlier. The Pica glass had huge vesicles running through it due to the rapid cooling, where this, as you described, is a lot, still cooled quickly, but it recrystallized as it did it.
Certainly, and that's a piece of dolomite, and I specifically included that one because, yeah, in the image you could see all the fine little needly crystals sitting in the very dark glassy material. That's the rest of it.
Yeah, I thought that was a great example.
Breccias. So again, you know, a breccia is kind of a less melted rock. So the definition of a classic terrestrial breccia is a material that's made of other pre-existing lithified clasts of rock that are typically angular in nature. Again, as you kind of get and blend between those melts and the breccias, you get those melt breccias, and some of those will have clasts that are a little more rounded. Obviously, because as the less altered pieces are sitting in molten rock, basically, you know, all the corners, think of an ice cube, right? It starts out, and as soon as you put it in the liquid, it starts kind of rounding the corners off and getting more comfortized. So you'll see some breccias out there with a little less angularity, but the majority of the breccias are very angular, and it's just bits of existing rock that have been crushed together to form a new rock.
I want to take a look at some of these a little bit closer. Excuse me. I know this right here is Alamo.
Yep, that's the Alamo breccia.
This is rice.
Yeah, that's a bit of rice, and you're gonna catch me on it because I don't have all of them memorized on top of my head.
Nice. Well, we're just gonna take a little scroll through them just to show the variations of them.
Yep. But if there's any of them you want to know more about, you could definitely let me know and just highlight a certain piece, and I'll pull the number off of it, and I'll put it in the chat afterwards.
Yes. Thank you. Yeah. Some of these are, like we were saying earlier, they're really pretty, actually. I don't mind saying that about a terrestrial rock. This might be the only time I say it, guys. So start the record button.
Okay. And then this is kind of the end of it. So shock targets, again, like I said, that's kind of the catch-all. That's the bits of any terrestrial material that was altered and affected by the impact forces. So again, like Oz's piece, a shatter cone is a great example. And one thing with the shatter cones, the points all point in the direction of the impact force location. So if you imagine, like, if you're cleaning snow off your driveway and you put the shovel down and you start pushing, you would think you would just make a clean straight line, but it never actually happens, right? The material you're pushing out of the way sticks a little bit, and you kind of end up with a cone or a wedge facing out the further you push. Based on that material not being able to move out of the way in a straight fashion, and it's pushing a little bit to the side of everything. So you'll get those shatter cones, which are 100% a definitive feature that's used to help prove that the impact was from a meteorite, because you don't get those formations in geology anywhere else besides shatter cones. Other things that happen is you get rock that completely powders and loses its structure. So you'll get what's called rock flour. That's very common at like meteorite crater, Barringer crater. You'll even get other things like the picture in the upper right, that's a cobble. And literally, if you look at it up close, it's got little indentations and smash marks all around it. So cobbles don't really lithify into breccias because they're so round and they don't lock together. But as they smash into each other from all those different sides, you can see all the shock impact hits as these things were getting thrown around in the force of a massive meteorite impact.
That helps explain it. I thought it looked more like an agate, but now I can see that there are impacts.
Yeah, it's really just a big quartz pebble, but it's completely covered in these little hit marks and little you know, secondary craters from smashing into all the rocks around it. And then finally, you got things like dislocated fossils, which I think Carl and Diane are going to show in the next section. And so, yeah, anytime you get such a large impact, whatever's in the ground will get disrupted. So fossils will get jointed and split. And I know Oz had a great piece of the rice crater shatter cones. Some of those shatter cones have fossils in them, too. They're really, really neat little bits of terrestrial leavings with both fossils and shatter cones and all sorts of cool stuff going on.
That is really awesome. Mike, can you explain to us what that big item is?
The large piece is located from the Panther Mountain impact structure. And the Panther Mountain impact structure is actually like an inverted crater. So all along where the rim was, the crater has sunk down underneath layers that were put down on top of it. And so all the joints in the rock have all cracked and follow a big circle around. So that's actually a large block that's been broken. And all the joints you see, those sharp angles, are parallel and perpendicular to the crater edge.
Very good. I knew if I put you on the spot, you'd have an answer. Yeah. Super. I super appreciate all the homework you do preparing these 101 lessons, the entire crew and everyone on YouTube really appreciates it. So Mike, thanks a lot. Really appreciate it, buddy.
No problem.
And kind of as you hinted, we are next going to Carl and Diane. They have a few specimens that they want to show us from their Impactite collection.
Hi, everybody. We're visiting Serpent Mound Crater today. And Serpent Mound Crater is named after Serpent Mound. Serpent Mound is an ancient Indian effigy mound that was created by the Adena culture about 2,000 years ago. And that's one of the largest effigy mounds in the world and one of only a few serpent mounds known in the world. The crater, it is interesting because this mound actually sits on the edge of a very large crater. It's a complex crater. This was formed roughly 320 million years ago by the impact of a large small asteroid. And the crater itself, the original diameter was around 14 kilometers or 8.7 miles. It has eroded down now to a crater that's only about maybe 5 miles across. This picture here, if you look at it, this was taken several miles to the south of where the crater is located, which is in the Highland County area of Southern Ohio. But standing on a high hill to the south of it, you can actually see the physical remnants of the crater on the horizon. And it's labeled clearly on the left and right. You'll see where the ring graben from the complex crater is. And in the central uplift areas where the higher hills are in the middle. And there's an eroded rim you can sort of make out when you're standing at the crater itself to the south. A diagram below shows you what a complex crater is where you get central uplift from the impact and the throwback and the shattering of everything underneath. This shows you more or less a rather, fairly simplistic map on the left showing where it's located in Ohio and the central peak or uplift area is located with a dot in red. That is an area where there's a lot of exposure of the shattered bedrock where you get shatter cones. There's also an area to the left of that where there's a nice exposure of a lot of the breccia that was the fallback breccia from the impact. This area was very interesting because this area in Southern Ohio is still part of what they call the Cincinnati Arch, which is a area of Ordovician and Silurian and Devonian rocks and very fossiliferous. It's also a very well-known fault zone, earthquake fault zone dating way back. And this meteorite came in and hit an already very disturbed area. So that area was already geologically messed up to begin with from being a fault zone. And then this impact hits and it really messed everything up. There's areas in this crater where you can go into a ravine and actually observe the different layers flip-flopped on top of each other. So you'll see Silurian lying on top of Devonian because it's flipped everything upside down. It's crazy. And this is a shatter cone that was collected from the central up-peak, central uplift area of the crater. It's about almost roughly 13 kilogram specimen and it's in the limestone area. Now, there is a lot of different layers of bedrock in the Sherman Mound area. So you'll find shatter cones not only in the limestone, as you see here, but you'll find it in shale. You'll find shatter cones in sandstone. So several different types of rock have shatter features in that crater. Makes it one of the more interesting craters on Earth, at least in my opinion.
Well, as most of the crew know, Carl and I have a large fossil collection, as well as the meteorites and impactites. The one on the left is what I like to call one of our crossover pieces. It is an impact-shattered fossil of something called a stromatoporoid. Stromatoporoids are an extinct group of sponges The right-hand picture is what they look like if they haven't been shattered and brecciated. You know, this got smashed by the impact and stuck back together by the heat afterward. So, you know, the brecciated one, that's what happened to it. You can see, particularly in the lower left, you can see there's a couple of wide bands that have obviously been broken and fused back into a solid mass. Looking now at the Nördlinger Ries crater in Germany, the white line marks the crater rim. And if you zoom in a little, you see just below and to the left of center, there's a small reddish circle. That is the town of Nördlinger. Medieval era town. This is Nördlinger. So you might be asking, why am I showing you city pictures or town pictures? Well, other than the fact that the architecture in a medieval town can be very interesting, there's two features I want to call your attention to. Notice the big church in the middle of town, and the whole town is enclosed in a circular defensive wall. Mm. Now, I mentioned this is in a crater. Those two structures are built, I'm not sure if it's entirely or just almost entirely, of the local impact breccia or suevite.
Yes, very cool.
Yeah, and in fact, that church, the rock in its walls was the first recognized impact material. When Eugene Shoemaker came to Nördlinger to see, is this a crater or a volcanic feature 50 years ago, he was looking for the rock. You know, the story I heard goes he was looking around and not finding breccia or shatter cones, and then he saw the church and said, whoa. And his wife looked at him and looked at the church and said, Gene, don't take any samples.
Those are holy relics.
Yeah.
But yeah, the church and the wall, you know, that was the stone that the medieval builders had available.
If it's laying around and pretty strong, you might as well use it. What the heck are these things?
Those are some more brecciated fossils. They are a type of critter called a belemnite. They looked kind of like squid, but they had an internal shell like a cuttlefish. And these two were in the bedrock when the crater hit. They're Cretaceous in age. The crater is about 14 and a half million years old. The rock it hit is about 50 million years older or more. I'm not sure exactly how old they are, but the fossils in it are Cretaceous age. Cretaceous came to an end 65 million years ago. And I should also mention the crater itself is about 15 miles across. Belemnites. On the left are some intact belemnite fossils from my collection. On the right is an artist's conception of what they might have looked like in life. They look a lot like squid. You know, picture squid with an internal shell, and that's pretty much what belemnites are like.
Thanks, Carl and Diane. I appreciate that. It was pretty. Next, we're going to move to Marissa, and Marissa has some really interesting stuff to show us. All right. So these are Marissa's samples and beautiful pictures. Tell us more about it, please.
Hi, guys. Well, I mainly collect meteorites, but I was also interested in every aspect of meteorites, even the impactor part where it affects the Earth. And I've got in the upper left-hand corner is one of my Wabar glass impactites. It's extremely tiny, but it's got a lot of character, and it is one of my most beautiful impactites. It's got that beautiful, like, almost bluish, but it's a grayish blue, like, matrix to it because of the sand composition and the impact, and it's even got some of the whitish, grayish material. But then it also has some of the reddish material. And I believe that is from the impactor itself from rust.
Oh, wow. Super interesting. I like that a lot.
Yeah, I love how there's so many bubbles to it, and you can see how it was so very melted.
I bet that's a pleasure to look at under the microscope and in all those tunnels and dig deep in there.
Oh, yeah, it's beautiful. And then I've got my little piece of moldavite. I'm glad I bought some of these when I did, now that they've exploded in price. And I'm very happy with my moderate little 2 gram piece. It's nothing too special, but it's a very beautiful piece. It's that classic green, and I'm happy I swept one when I did.
Yeah, let me interject for 1 second, if you don't mind, Marissa. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of fake in the world, but there's a lot of fake moldavite being offered out there. This is a good example of how to tell a real moldavite from a fake moldavite. A fake moldavite is going to be a solid piece of glass that's acid etched or carved or whatever they want to do to make it look, give it that pattern on the outside. But this pattern, as you can see, goes all the way through the rock or the glass. You see it go all the way through. Here you see another line going all the way through. There's bubbles over here. There's little hollow spots. This is, and it has a sharp edge around the outside. You can see even these little divots right here. These are typical, and like this sharp edge. This is a piece of glass. If you wanted to peel a carrot with that, you probably could. With a fake moldavite, you're not going to have those edges. You're not going to have these internal structure that proves it's a real moldavite.
And next, I've got my Libyan desert glass, which I know we've seen a bunch of, but this is a beautiful example. I'm extremely sad about this. When I bought it, it was in perfect condition. There were no chips. I bought it in Tucson in 2016. And unfortunately, when I unpacked it from all my moving, it broke.
Oh.
A tiny little end broke off, and I got actually a little cut from handling it. So be careful with these. These are glass.
Yeah. So, yeah. I was kind of joking a second ago, like you could peel a carrot with it, but you can cut your finger with it too, because these are glass and they will break. And can I ask you, and I don't want to put you on, I don't mean to put you on the spot, but I am. What are we looking at? And some of the samples we saw earlier, like Ron's, I told you they're available in different colors, or they're produced in different colors. Yours is a nice honey amber, if you will, but it has all these dark things on there. Do you know what that is?
I'm actually not sure what those are. I assumed it was like glass and maybe some impurities, and maybe that's how some of them came out to be, with, because I've seen darker Libyan desert glass, as we saw with Ron earlier. So I assumed that that's what this one has a little bit of, either that or I'm mistaken, it could be dirt or something. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to ask the crew if anyone has any information about it. I have an opinion of what
Ken
I think
did
it is, but
on the chat, he said it might be sand infused.
Okay, we're on the same boat. If anyone wants to correct me or add more knowledge, that's possible. But a lot of times these actually have unmelted sand on the outside. So you have a pure liquefied piece of glass, but on the outside, when it landed or whatever, other pieces of sand stuck to it, melted to it, but not totally melted into a glass form. And I think that's what this piece displays pretty well.
Hey, Topher, too, yes. if you look at Mercer's piece, I got a feeling that was sitting down. You know how when we look at meteorites, you all get the top is more ventifact, weather-worn? Mm-hmm. If you look at the top half of her piece, you know, it's got that nice rounded over ventifact smoothing going on. Yep. But where you see all the adhered material, it's definitely more angular. You can tell it's a little bit etched, but everything's a little more coarse and the corners haven't been rounded. So that was when it was found, is probably sitting relatively close to, you know, that being the berry line, you know, cutting across the piece. So the part that's dark was the underground part, and the part that's worn up top was exposed and weathered.
Great, great points. Do you think that the dark material is dark because of acid etching or because of external sand that didn't melt?
I think it's just an external material that's adhered to it, yeah, from the location.
Okay, thank you very much. Marissa, we have another slide of your impactites. Talk us through this.
So on the top left, I've got a whole piece of Alamo breccia. You can see all the brecciation and the darker areas versus the lighter areas. I'm quite happy that I've got a whole piece and not a slice, because I like to see the outside, and it gives a better example of what you would be looking for out at one of these sites if you're going to collect any breccia.
Good point. Yeah. And in this piece too, you can see these lines right here, how they run parallel. There was obviously some force maybe pushing down that caused these to squeeze out. I'm not an impact kind of guy myself, so I don't know. I'm just telling you what I see here, or what I'm experiencing.
And then the last two are my Indochinites. Collectively, they weigh about 60 to 65 grams, somewhere in that range. So they're pretty decently big. And that elongated one is the only example I have of, kind of a dumbbell shape.
With the pitted outside, it's pretty easy to tell exactly what that is. This one, on the other hand, looks a little bit different.
Very nice.
Yeah, that was the prettier side, where you could really see the flow and the movement of the glass and how it was melted. And I just loved that. I thought that was gorgeous.
And that's one of the unique features of real tektites too, is that they'll have schistivite and coesite in them, which are high pressure pseudomorphs of quartz. And that streaky structure towards the bottom shows that movement of the glass, and probably in there someplace there's schistivite and coesite.
Perfect. I almost cut Marissa off. I forgot she has some other stuff to share with us that's not in my presentation. So Marissa, please explain what we're looking at.
Well, I have not only gone meteorite hunting, I have also been impactite hunting as well. As it so happens, in my home state of Ohio, there is an impact crater. It's a very old impact crater, and it is in southern Ohio. It is called the Serpent's Mound Impact Crater. And this impact crater is very old. It is about 320 million years old or younger is what is estimated it to be. And it is estimated at 14 kilometers or 8.7 miles wide.
Wow.
It's a very old crater, so it's almost completely eroded away. I know there's one spot that you could go to see the outer rings, but I have not ever done that. So I went down there with my good friend, Mike, and we went down there to try to find some impactites.
Nice. Dare I ask, were you successful?
I was successful. We were able to find an outcrop. It was a cliff face that had been uplifted. It was the only one we could find. I do have a picture of that.
Oh, wow. Is this the actual side of the crater that we're looking at?
I don't believe it is. I think it's just a cliff face that has been uplifted.
Gotcha.
And it was the only thing, it was the only spot we could find. And I'm pretty sure that a lot of people have been here collecting samples. And unfortunately today, I don't think anybody can, because this is in the middle of nowhere. And somebody does live on the top of this. And I guess they've been chasing people away with a shotgun. It's a little ridiculous to me for somebody to chase people away over a cliff face. It is dubbed Serpent's Mound Impact Crater because there is a Native American mound within the crater. And mm-hmm. it is in the shape of a serpent. I've been there. It's really beautiful. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if it is a protected site, like the whole crater. It's very old and it's very eroded. I don't see why it would be protected. And there's no more of the impactor. That's completely gone and it probably vaporized. So there is a mound in there, and I'm not aware of any Native Americans trying to make the whole crater site like a historic site and protect it. But I do know the mound area is protected and there's a museum there.
Yeah, good. I'm glad that it's, well, it's nice to be able to experience nature, but it's also nice for the next generation to be able to experience the nature.
Yeah, it was a very fun trip, but we were only there for one day and for a few hours. It took me 4 hours to get down there from where I am. It was quite a long haul, but very worth it to be in my first impact crater.
Yeah.
Nice.
You inspire us every single week, and then you tell us stories like you going down inside craters. Like, I haven't done that. I'm weak. So, thank you really much. I really appreciate that.
You're welcome.
There is one thing that's super interesting and unique about impact material versus meteorites. Meteorites are beautiful, and you can cut them based in any shape you want. There's stony ones that are more geared towards jewelry making. But let's face it, the Earth is a harsh environment for meteorites, and the human body is even worse for meteorites. We have oils and grease, and we're breathing out moist air all the time. So there's a lot of people that want to make meteorite jewelry, and they ask me to buy meteorites for me to make jewelry, and I have to basically talk them out of it. However, we do have a artist on our crew who makes her own jewelry with wire wrapping, and Sue and Allison are going to show us a little bit of their creations. So give me 1 second. All right, Sue and Allison, I'm gonna let you guys take the mic. I'm just gonna show you what I have. Here's a tektite necklace.
Sue had sent me some tektites, and one of the first things that I noticed is that if you hold the tektite up to the light, oftentimes the light will shine through it. And I thought, how brilliant would it be to wire wrap it? So even if you didn't wear it as a piece of jewelry, if you just hung it in a window or something, you could really enjoy it better that way than you could in a case or a Riker box or something. So I thought it was a good opportunity to get started there. And then we've done some other, like Topher said, meteorite jewelry. And he did mention that it's not good to have your body oils on these things. And so, Sue and I would encourage you guys, if you're going to purchase any of these jewelry, to take them off before you shower or go to bed. Mm-hmm. You wear them and enjoy them, absolutely. But try to keep protect them from the elements a little bit.
This absolutely. One blew me away. This one blew me away.
Oh, I love this one.
Wow.
It's one of my favorites.
Very pretty.
Yeah, nice scroll work.
I took the pendant and I made it more into like a, I wanted it like a industrial kind of like steampunk, like lots of thick metal kind of look. I really like the look of that one. I kind of don't want to sell it.
You can see through the.
You just increased the value of that piece five.
I wasn't trying to. I love that one.
Yeah. And what I really like, because I'm not an artist at all, is this intricate wire wrapping, Allison. You do fantastic artistic stuff.
I'm not going to take credit for that one.
That one wasn't Allison's, honey.
I'm totally sorry about that.
So the first one was.
Yeah.
Ken mentioned too in the chat that this is stuff that men can wear also.
Yes, so. I've been trying to tell Topher, like, get ready. I need you to start modeling some, manly necklaces for me. And I don't know if he's looking forward to or not.
No,
this next one is Libyan Desert Glass that we had that Topher bought in Tucson at the Tucson 2022 show. And I sent this over to Allison and she sent it back. And this one was probably... of the first set of necklaces you said, this was my very favorite. I loved it. Yeah. I added some like little gems to it. It's just so pretty.
Very nice.
Yeah, and if you keep the wire wrapping pretty simple, then you can really still enjoy the stones. So I do try to just let the stone tell me where the wire wants to go and keep it pretty minimal.
We have another one coming your way that we need you to wrap for us because it definitely needs some help.
That's spell on you.
One's fine. That one's fine. Yeah. It's the Tektite that I need Allison wire wrap.
Yeah.
That one's a Moldavite. I love that one. I just think it's so pretty.
What are the accent stones in with a Moldavite?
I have to be honest, I don't remember, but okay. I know that I believe it's, I want to say it's 24 karat gold or gold plated. But I mean, just the Moldavite's my favorite part of it. It's just so angular and like, I mean, it's just so pretty. Look at that. I think that's one of like our most expensive pieces. Like it is just like, I mean, that's like royalty level, I think.
Yeah. The goal was really just to kind of show off what can be done with less expensive materials and someone who knows what they're doing. Like this Libyan Desert Glass. This, I think you captured it really well. Mm-hmm. And like Sue said, this is her favorite one that we got back.
Do I not? Every time we are like, rearranging and organizing, I'm like, I want to keep this one too. I love it. I love it so much.
Absolutely.
I like that one.
I really like the Tektite. The Libyan Desert Glass is my favorite.
Yeah, when you hold those up to the light, they're absolutely stunning.
Yeah. I had a flashlight on earlier and it's like lime green around the edges.
It is, yeah. And then a lot of the pieces that I make will have an adjustable chain or cotton rope on it. And so you can bring it up if you like or drop it down if you like. And then some of the pieces that I make too will have just one bead that you'll pull for the length, and you can be creative and bring that bead around the front if you like, or put it in the back if you like. So I was creative making the jewelry. Be creative wearing
it. And we're gonna have to pop a picture of you doing that, because I was looking at the pictures of you wearing the jewelry and I saw that you brought the bead up to the front.
Yeah.
And it looks really cool like that.
So
yeah, it's fun.
There's lots of options and things you can do with Tektites and Impactites and Moldavite as it relates to jewelry. And that's probably gonna be a safer experience for you and long-term for the jewelry, for the meteorite. We do have some materials that Allison made that are just stunning. My favorite one are slices of just small chondrites, but you see all of the metal in there. And the way she wrapped it, it's a nominal wrap. It's around the outside with only one bar going around. So you really see the meteorite stone. I just thought you did a terrific job on that one, Allison.
So yeah, she also had made jewelry out of petrified wood, as well as antique bone. Yeah. Everything she does is just gorgeous and really brings out the best of like the natural aspect of it. It's just really pretty, and it really fits to her personality too.
Yeah.
Can I ask a question, girl?
Uh huh.
Where are you able to purchase these things? That's what I would like to know. They're very beautiful.
We are almost done, and we're almost ready to release several lines. And I would say probably within the next week, you will be seeing them online. And I literally put an announcement on our Etsy page yesterday, letting everyone know that Sue Sparkles and Prairie Girl Jewelry Designs will be releasing a bunch of jewelry. I'll probably have at least 100 jewelry items out on the Etsy site.
Ooh, that'll be nice to see.
That was awesome. So that's another way to enjoy meteorites and impact material in your daily life with jewelry. Our final show and tell of the day is Mike Kelly, and he has a few samples to explain to us. Mike, go for it, buddy.
Certainly. So I wanted to show off a couple of impactites you don't see all too often. So this first one is from a location that everyone knows and loves. This is from Meteorite Crater. And what this is a piece of kaibab limestone bomb. So a lot of different people went around and went to the crater before Nininger went there. But these were a thing that Nininger first pointed out. So sitting on top of the layer of breccia in the crater, he found a whole bunch of little tannish brown blobs, some of them with aerial form, some of them with droplets. And these are melted bits of limestone that got thrown into the air and landed back on top of the breccia. And you can see they're full of vesicles because as you cook limestone, all of the carbon dioxide tries to come out of it and bubbles out and gets stuck a lot of times. It forms those big bubbles. So that's a Nininger provenance type material that you don't see all too often on the market.
No.
Awesome.
One of the other ones I wanted to show, we talked about just how far tektites are from their source location. So this is a Badia site, and these are found in College Station, Texas. And the crater that formed them is the Chesapeake Bay crater, all the way over on the coast.
Yeah. Wow.
So this one's only about 10 grams, but this is a piece near and dear to my heart in my impactite collection. Because I found this on the one day I had to go hunting out in College Station.
Whoa.
The last stop of the day. We were hitting one stop last as the sun was going down. And literally within like the last 10 minutes of us getting ready to call it quits, I found this.
Wow.
Winner.
Winner.
Yep. I'm gonna cheat a little bit. So Topher said we weren't seeing meteorites today. The meteorite. Sneak a meteorite in. So we talked about craters the other time, and we're gonna get rid of that meteorite because that was Henbury. But the focus is there aren't all that many craters that you can get meteorites and impactites from. But Henbury is one of them, besides Meteorite Crater with those bomblets. So this is a piece of glassy material, and you can see it's very vesicular from the Henbury crater site.
Wow.
And again, you don't see it too often on the market, but it is around if you keep your eyes out, so you can collect the impactite to go with the meteorite.
That completes it nicely.
Yep, it's nice to have a set. And then I got two more to show real quick. So we talked, I talked about there being one type of tektite that I missed out on putting on my list. And I'll have to forgive myself. It is the newest tektite that's been approved. So these are Belizeites. So these are found in Belize based on the name. And they weren't really figured out till about 1995. The first one showed up in 1990 when they were digging around an old Mayan rune site called Bullet Tree Falls.
And they found a couple of these little black pebbles, and it took a couple more years, and the gentleman who found them went to a museum and saw tektites and put two and two together.
Oh.
And kind of said, hey, you know, maybe these are them. And then after a couple more years of research and study, in 1995, they found them in the actual locations that they were buried in, did the science on it. Like we said, you know, it's got to be glass. It's got to be super high purity. And these passed all the tests. And so these are Belizeites.
Very cool.
And then the final one I wanted to show is a piece of vertifort. So what's cool about this one is vertifort is the largest impact structure on the planet. It's originally estimated that the crater was probably somewhere between 100 to 200 miles across. For a long time, it held the status as oldest crater also, in addition to largest.
Yeah.
But they did back in about 2012 or 2014 find a crater under the Greenland ice sheet, and they're thinking that one's about 3 billion years old, whereas vertifort's guessed to be about 2 billion years old. But this is a pretty cool impact type, because what happened was such a massive impact shattered all the bedrock, and all the melt trickled down into all of the fractures underneath the crater structure. So it forms these dikes, which are like, you know, lines of melt that drip down into these cracks. And so you can see the material, some of the flow kind of going on with the veining going through it as it melted and settled in underneath the crater structure. And like Pat mentioned, there's coesite in there and stichovite and all sorts of high pressure conversions of minerals to their high pressure forms.
Dissociated bedrock?
What was that?
Was this silicated bedrock?
So the original material is called griffinfire, and it's a material that's made out of quartz and alkali feldspar.
Okay.
So yeah, there's quartz, you know, silica in there, and some of that got converted over to high pressure polymorphs, and other bits of the quartz grains show what's called planar deformation fractures. So the quartz grains are all shattered.
Wow.
Well, thank you very much for showing those things off. I have a question for you, because I live in Arizona outside Phoenix, and there is a town in Arizona called Saffordite, or Safford. And in Safford and around Safford, they collect Saffordites. Now, I'm told they're pseudo tektites, not real tektites. I'm going to put you on the spot. You got 30 seconds. Explain it.
Sure. Yeah. So they are literally pieces of obsidian that have gone through similar weathering that causes the structure and outside of a tektite to look the way it does, mostly acid etching. Again, their purity and the silica content is not high enough. Their moisture content is too high. They're not anhydrous enough. And if you look at them, the tektites, you know, obviously the moldavites are greenish. If you look at these tektites, again, strong light, they'll be greenish brown. If you look at a saffordite, it'll be grayish, and it'll also be layered. So the only layered tektites out there are Monk Nong tektites. And again, the color's off, the content's off. Basically, you have an etched piece of natural glass obsidian.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate you allowing me to put you on the spot and ask that question, because we didn't prepare this ahead of time, but I knew, man, if there's one person in the room to ask, you're the cat. So thank you very much.
Yeah, no worries.
Before we cut the episode at the end, we're going to jump to Sue for a little bit of an announcement. Sue?
Hey, guys. More of just a message to share with the viewers that are tuning in every week and watching us and really feel like they want to be a part of the crew, or just at least, you know, join us a few times, but they're hesitant, or a lot of people reach out to me and tell me that they're really nervous about being on camera and, you know, things like that. So I just want to remind people that we do non-recorded hangouts and these recorded. So I warmly welcome, everybody is welcome to come join us. We're probably not gonna put you on camera the first time you join, if you join on a recorded night, but if you come on a non-recorded night, we pretty much have an anything goes rule within reason. And we just, you know, I just want people to know that they can join in any capacity that they want. They can join just, you know, on those nights, they can just do audio. They can just come and sit and just like not, you know, jump in and talk or be on video if they just want to kind of watch and see what it's like. We're always welcoming, you know, seasoned collectors as well as people who have just discovered meteorites the day before and they know little to nothing. So, you know, please feel free to join us anytime. Don't be shy.
Awesome. Thank you very much for that invitation and explaining that, because we do want everyone who's interested to be able to partake in whatever way they feel comfortable. On the non-recorded shows, there's a lot more laughing and a lot more giggling and a lot less production. So it's usually a little bit easier time.
We have a really good time during the recorded hangouts, but I would liken for the crew, I would say that they would probably say this is like a school class that they really like going to, whereas the non-recorded is more like recess, you know, like, or hanging out after. Like, it's just a lot more fun and like a little bit more relaxed. So we had a really great time last week. I think everybody can agree. The people that weren't there were like, what was going on? There were so many posts in the group. Like, everybody was sharing. It was just really interactive. So yeah, thanks for everybody that came last week. So.
And that's part of the goal, is we want to open up the community and make everyone feel welcome. So thank you, Sue. I appreciate that. Everyone, thanks for watching. Even though we didn't have meteorites today, I hope you had a blast like we did. Take care, and we'll see you in a few weeks.
Take care.
Bye.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye.